From now on, you can call me Grace Skywalker. Don't worry, Luke and Leia's force ghosts are right off camera and they're giving me the thumbs up. It doesn't work that way. You just can't take someone else's name like that. Why isn't everyone, although I guess everyone is kind of using the force these days, according to Finn, so they're all Skywalkers. Way to dilute the importance of a name. And also, I would like to keep my own identity, thank you very much, and I think Rey should do the same. Why can't she just be like Cher or Madonna? She doesn't need two names. She's the last Jedi. Well, how did that happen too? All right, so anyway, we have a lot to discuss. And speaking of Rey, what the heck did Finn want to say to her, right? We never found out, although it was awfully transparent. We all know, which just makes it all the more awkward and embarrassing for not just the one, but the two alternate love interests that this trilogy has inexplicably tried to give Finn, after first making it seem like he was going to be with Rey, and then not only did they give him these alternate female love interests, and one male love, possible love interest, but also they then have him reject both of them. It's like really weird. Although John Boyega has proven to be such a loose cannon at this point that maybe Finn was supposed to like one of them, but on set, John Boyega, when they come to film the scene, he's like, nope, if it's not the leading lady, I don't want it. And I don't blame him. Stick to your guns, Finn. You were promised the leading lady. It is weird that they would have him like bring it up as a running, like he would try and say something before he died. They would make it a running gag, which I thought was effective in the film. I liked when Poe Dameron was on fire in this movie, and he came up and he's like, oh, you want to wait until Poe's not around? And then he asked him again later, and he was like, what, you gonna save it? It was so good. But then not to let us know. I mean, I guess because, again, it was obvious. But then it just points to those other problems. All right, so let's discuss Star Wars The Rise of Skywalker with spoilers. There's so much to cover. I'm going to be referring to my notes as I discuss it. Because not only is there a lot, but it's just so disjointed and all over the place. So it doesn't even have, like, there's not an organic flow to the actual story, so it's hard to, like, have a flow to the conversation about it. Except if you're, let the anger flow through you. We're all Sith talking about this movie. I liked when Rey got really angry. I was like, I've been there, Rey. I really thought that was great. I think anger, you know, is this what they were discussing? I think somewhere recently, it was like, I thought I was angry, but Watchmen. I thought, you know, Hooded Justice was saying, oh, I thought I was angry, but it was actually fear. That was very interesting. And I kind of put that on this a little bit. I don't think you should be so, I think anger, as long as you don't let it consume you, it's not that bad. I wanted Rey to be a great Jedi. We're gonna get to it, we'll talk about it. But I'm basically gonna go through the big reveals and some of the characters will be covered in that, but then if they're not, we'll go character by character afterwards. And of course, as always, there are chapter times where you can jump, you know, via the links in the video description to anything you want to talk about right now. All right, so what I want to talk about first is the big reveal that infuriated me, and that was the return of Han Solo. It's apparently gotten out because people have asked me about it online and in real life. What in real life? Now after I've seen the movie, and I'm like, how did you know Han Solo was in there? I mean, I knew most of the surprises in this film, but this one genuinely I was like, what? And I think it made me even angrier. So he came back as a regular ghost. He's not like a force ghost or anything, although he wasn't see-through at all. He just looked like Harrison Ford standing there. And he apparently gives Kylo Ren the excuse that Kylo Ren was waiting for to go back to being Ben Solo. He was like, finally, thanks, Pops. I stabbed you, and why'd it take you so long to forgive me? I'm like, he should never forgive him. Here's it, because I'm never going to forgive Harrison Ford. Harrison Ford wanted out of this franchise so badly, but he would, you know, he'll take the franchise's money, that he insisted on a totally rushed and inappropriate ending for Han Solo. So you can't come back after that. You want it out? Bye. Bye-bye. And also, it made me feel like this was Disney trying to make up for the original trio never getting to have a scene together in any of these new movies. They just sprinkled them throughout this one. And it's like, no! No, no, no! It's still not what we wanted, and I'm not gonna let you make up for that. No! I mean, Harrison Ford, I was just as upset when he first stepped out on that platform 4 years ago, when this whole mess started. And I think I think Harrison Ford, to me, is the symbol of the decisions being made for this franchise, not what benefits it creatively, but how the people who are making it personally feel, what they want Star Wars to be. They know better. They made a mistake, let them fix it in a sloppy, ineffective way. So it's, and those are the people who are wrongly entrusted with this franchise, and it's very upsetting. I wish they had given Star Wars to people who actually like Star Wars. That's something to think about going forward. Maybe that's why The Mandalorian, I still think The Mandalorian isn't a home run either. To me, still, Rogue One was just the best. So I'm very excited about Tony Gilroy returning to do a Cassian Andor and K2SO Disney Plus series. And I have high hopes for the Obi-Wan one as well, especially with Deborah Chow in the director's, in the showrunner's seat. All right, so anyway, let's talk about some of the old characters first. So Luke Skywalker, yes, he does show up, but he never gets his lightsaber battle. He still kind of has a bad attitude. I did like when his hand stuck out from the burning, Kylo Ren's ship that looks like a TIE fighter. And he was like, don't throw your lightsaber. Everyone was chucking lightsabers left and right. We'll talk about that a little later in the review. But he was like, don't throw this away yet. And so that surprised me. I was like, oh, that was kind of cool. He knew how to make an entrance. And also when he raised the X-Wing, I thought that was nice. Like out of like, it would seem like it was swamp-like, of course, this being in the swamp when he trained with Yoda, but here, this really wasn't a swamp, it was this island, but it had some stuff on it, had some schmutz on the X-Wing. That was kind of cool. But then it was interesting. That was one of the few points in the movie where Rey didn't look cool, right? I guess also because I was like, how much like Luke Skywalker are you gonna get? This is ridiculous. Side note though, speaking of pilots, John Williams had a cameo as a pilot at the very end in the big finale. Wasn't that cool? He was like, nice flying. I was like, who is that? He looked familiar. And then in the credits, it was like John Williams. And I was like, oh, John Williams. Always watch the pilots closely in a Star Wars movie, because chances are, they're somebody. All right, so Lando, he had really no role at all. And he didn't talk to anyone. When Rey was like, tell Leia yourself to say hi. Lando should have retorted, Kathleen Kennedy won't let me. Thank you very much. I was like, don't hold that against Lando. He would love to. And then as for Leia, I talked a lot about that in my non-spoiler review, how they just could not splice in this old footage effectively. And it didn't work. And there was such a large chunk of the movie. I think it hurt the film. It was one of the many things that hurt the film. But then, of course, we can talk about here how she disappeared under the blanket when she disintegrated after dying, right? I thought that was, like, really anticlimactic. And I think she could have reached out to her son a long time ago. She's like, I guess it's time. And you're like, now it's time? What about when, couldn't you keep him from killing your husband? She's like, Han left me. I wasn't really too nervous about what was going to happen to Han, quite frankly. But yeah, Leia in this whole trilogy has never seemed like the Leia from the original. None of the characters have. Luke, Han, and Leia have never seemed like the Luke, Han, and Leia from the original. I guess Lon would be their couple name, right? I think Heya sounds a little bit better. But anyway, they haven't ever been what they were like in the original trilogy, which is why I think they also haven't felt that satisfaction of seeing them again. All right, so let's talk about some of the big surprises. So Rey Palpatine, right? They're like, what's your family name? Careful what you wish for. It's Palpatine. I knew that. That had been spoiled a long time ago. So when they said it in the movie, there was like, also, I think everyone knew it. There was no reaction when he was like, you're a Palpatine. And everyone, just dead silence from the press screening. No one was like, everyone was just like, yeah, we know. And also, whatever. So the Emperor, of course, is alive, which they showed immediately at the beginning of the movie. And he's on a crane. I kind of liked him being on a crane. He was like, it was like a Death Eater from Harry Potter, right? With a walker. That was kind of what it was. But I liked the way he kind of like moved around on the end of the crane with his cloak kind of swaying in the wind because he had no legs. I thought that was kind of funny. But also, I was wondering how he made that fleet at the beginning of the movie that he rose up out of the ice. I was like, where'd that come from? How many people are on this planet working with you? How did you build so many starships? It seemed impossible to me, quite frankly. What does he have, a VFX team there? He just goes, it's easy. I copy and duplicate them and just have them go on forever. I'm like, you had to actually build those. It's like, and where did you get the raw materials to build so many things? It was crazy to me. He's like, this is actually a hollow planet after we've mined it. Also, speaking of things they made there, when Kylo Ren first came in, you saw those Snoke clones, right? Like in a jar. Snoke's in a jar. And I was like, whatever, I don't care. Like any other franchise, you'd be like, what's that mean? And here you're like, keep walking. I don't even want to go there. I don't want to open that jar, Snoke's. And then also it reminded me, where were our Rey clones? I much preferred the idea that Rey was a clone and she would come across other Rey clones. But instead, evil Rey from the trailers was just a vision, as some people had predicted. Darn it, you were right, it's nothing. Although I did like her little sharp teeth when she hissed for a moment. I was like, oh, that's pretty cool. And then we never saw her again. I was like, want to have another nightmare, Rey? This movie could use it. Although, speaking of Rey's past, they revealed her parents, and her father was the son of Palpatine. like what? Palpatine Jr., Joe Palpatine. Like, who? Like, talk about, like, he never amounted to anything. But, you know, he didn't want to. He didn't want to be his father's son. But he married Jodie Comer, which was so cool. The non-Palpatine made the biggest impression. And kudos to Jodie Comer for making such a strong impression. Not just for being Jodie Comer. She did a great job with, like, two fleeting scenes. She was great. It's weird, though, that it was the son of Palpatine, and they didn't really give him any lines, and they focused just on the mom. I was like, shouldn't you focus on the line of the Palpatine? Maybe? All right. Or maybe at least Jodie Comer being like, I can't believe I married into the Palpatine family. How did you think that was going to go? All right, so Rey, of course, being a Palpatine, had Force Lightning, which was amazing. I really liked that sequence. I liked the hand acting when she was trying to hold the ship. I really felt the strain. I was like, this is amazing. Daisy Ridley has really cool hands. I like them. They're gender neutral, you know, and I think that's partially how she handles herself. She's very interesting. I think she did a really interesting job with Rey. But I thought that was great. I thought the way that whole sequence with pulling the transport down and her just being so angry, and she's like, quit stalking me, Kylo Ren. And it particularly bothers me because I kind of like you too. It was great. I thought that all that stuff was really excellent. And then she just erupted with the lightning. I thought that was one of the coolest scenes in the movie to me. My other favorite scene was when she took on Palpatine at the end. And Palpatine had a pretty good light show himself. He was like, oh, look at this, hold my space beer. I was like, that's pretty cool. And Rey was just looking up at it being like, I've had enough of this boy. But then when she went up against him, all the Sith versus all the Jedi, that was a pretty cool line. I liked that exchange. And I didn't care for the voices, though. Some of you were like, oh, it's my favorite voice. I couldn't tell anyone's voices are. They're all mixed together. They didn't say anything particularly interesting. I couldn't tell. I was just like, oh, yeah, there's a lot of people in there. I could tell, like, Luke, and that was it. But I did like when she crossed the two lightsabers against the lightning, and she was walking towards him. She did a little Wonder Woman, right, with the crossing the lightsabers instead of the arms. But I thought that was really cool, and I thought that she did that physicality really well. I thought it was very believable. I just thought it was excellent. Really, really, I thought visually stunning. Loved it. Really well executed. But then at the end, I thought, some people are saying she got a white lightsaber, which would make me very happy because, of course, that's the saber of the Grey Jedi, who are both, Jedi and Sith. You know, they're both good and bad. But it looked like a yellow lightsaber to me. Maybe it was just the light of Tatooine, but it looked like a yellow lightsaber. I was like, yellow? That's like not even, not only is it not a white lightsaber, but that's a horrible color. She should be like, I need to go to the shop at Galaxy's Edge and build me a new lightsaber. Maybe that's why they're having everyone throw their lightsabers away. They're like, go build another one at Galaxy's Edge. But then I shit the Skywalker name, which I thought was ridiculous. I really didn't like that at all. And she, of course, went to their old home, and I was like, stop it with the nostalgia. I can't take it anymore. The Ewoks showing up, you're like, this is ridiculous. And then also, as I said, the idea that anyone can tap into the Force. So being a Jedi apparently means nothing, right? Everyone gets a Participation Force Award. And then also, what about that kid from the end of the last Jedi, right, who could clean with the Force? What happened there? And why can Finn kind of tap into the Force? And apparently the Force was talking to all these Stormtroopers. Apparently the Force is just another word for doing the right thing, right? I guess that makes it a little sexier, right? I mean, like, doing the right thing seems a little boring, but if the Force is telling me to do it, well then, I am the chosen one. You can't be the chosen one if everyone's chosen. All right, so Reylo. Let's talk about Reylo. I love Reylo. I'm a big Reylo fan, even though he killed her mentor. That was pretty bad. But you can't deny the chemistry between Adam Driver and Daisy Ridley. It's off the charts nuts. I read a review from someone else, I think it was the Hollywood Reporter, where they said it was weird that Kylo Ren was so obsessed with Rey and having her rule with him and them being a pair. And I was like, no, are you kidding? That's an amazing chemistry. That doesn't come along all the time. I think, of course he would be. I think they were both really like, what is this something? That to me works. And I like their force connection. I think it's really interesting. All their scenes together to me were fantastic. I loved when they talk on the force. I think it's super sexy. I liked also when he grabbed the necklace off of her and that setup, of course, when she handed him the lightsaber later, we'll get to that in a moment. That was so cool. I liked also when he was like, where are you right now? We were like, she's on your ship. She's in your bedroom. Oh, she's reading a diary, Kylo. But, you know, she kind of was. And then when he saw the mask, he was like, I know where you are. That was awesome. And then when he confronted her on the ship, and then she jumped onto the Millennium Falcon using the Force, and, you know, and the wind was coming from the Millennium Falcon, you know, and all the Stormtroopers were blown away, but Kylo was able to stand firm. I was like, that guy's so cool. It was great. Now, they never really... I liked their lightsaber battle quite a bit. I liked how they were flipping around. I liked how they were trying to test each other, but also holding back because they liked each other. It was great. It was a really great lightsaber battle, and that's what's been missing from this new trilogy. And so I really thought it was fantastic with the waves crashing on them, and they're like, oh, I don't want to do this because I don't trust myself around you. And then she killed him. She had the nerve to do it with his own lightsaber, but then she healed him by giving some of her own life. We'll talk about how that was turned around in a moment. But I thought that was great. And then when she said to him, I did want to take Ben's hand. I mean, that was great stuff. Great, great, great stuff. But as for their bond, I don't think they ever really get a good job explaining it. They said something, Kylo said something about, well, we both have evil relatives, but we both have good relatives. And I was like, that's all it takes? A lot of people then could probably get in on this party line. But I did like when they handed off the lightsaber with, you know, facing off against, you know, he was facing off against the Knights of Ren and she was facing off against Palpatine. The way they did that, I just thought it was cool. Although, when they had the flashback to Luke and Leia practicing with their lightsabers, he clearly had a green saber and Leia had a blue. But then they both had blue when they went to fight Palpatine. I was like, you know, this lightsaber color thing is not working out. And also, going back to the lightsabers, here's where I had in my notes about the chucking of the lightsabers. He throws his lightsaber into the ocean. Luke threw his lightsaber over the cliff, right? You know, she buries the lightsabers. I'm like, again, aren't these hard to come by? And I did think it was funny that when Ben decided to, you know, also, his costume seemed less cool this movie. Like, he looked like he was walking around in a rain poncho when he was Kylo Ren. And then when he took off the poncho, he looked like he just had a crew neck sweater on. I was like, casual day, eh, Kylo? I am happy they kissed. As a fan of Reylo, I'm very happy. I was literally on the edge of my seat because they did a really good job dragging it out. And I got scared they weren't going to kiss. I was like, are you kidding me? If you're going to do Reylo, do Reylo. But they finally did. And I was so happy. I thought it was a very good kiss. It was very romantic. But then he died. And it made me so angry. I was like, this is very unsatisfying. And he didn't even come back as a ghost to be like, hey, I would have liked to, you know, if you're going to redeem Kylo Ren, let them be a cool new couple. And then that's the story I maybe would be interested in continuing in the movies. But as is, I don't have any interest in following just Rey by herself. I think it's interesting. I think Rey and Kylo Ren make each other more interesting as characters. And if you get rid of one of them, you're less interested in the other. But at least we got that. That's to me, I think, the Kylo Ren and Rey parts of the movie are the best parts of the movie. Although I do like the Finn and Poe stuff too. We'll get to that. So as for Ben Solo, after Undercover Boss, you know, that segment they did on Saturday Night Live, there's always a comedic element, I think, to his portrayal of Kylo Ren. I love that General Hux, I sense you have a problem with the way I look. And General Hux is like, no, that's a great helmet. I love it. That was hilarious. I felt very bad that they got rid of General Hux. I thought it was hilarious when he said, I am the spy. My whole audience laughed. It was so funny. I mean, he's sure he's an over-the-top character, but that's kind of the beauty of it. He's ridiculous, but also very dangerous at the same time. I liked when he said, I don't care if you win. I just want Kylo Ren to lose. I think that's another character I would have liked to have stuck around. I think he's great. And the way he was killed was just so unceremonious. I mean, they keep so many people around as prisoners, you know, just because so they could, like, Chewie. Like, Chewie was captured for, like, a hot second, right? Like, take him to interrogation room 6 and make sure you wait a ridiculously long time to start said interrogation so he can be rescued. Why not put why not put General Hux in interrogation room 5? So that was funny. But, you know, Kylo Ren with the Knights of Ren, that was just a waste. as I talked about in my non-spoiler review. The whole reason this character works, I think, is because of Adam Driver. And because they use the Zuko model from Avatar The Last Airbender. Too hot to be evil, right? You're like, it's the same thing that kind of happened with the Winter Soldier. You're like, I mean, although, of course, they redeemed that character first in the comics. But, you know, you're like, we have to redeem him. He can't be evil. He's too hot. But I thought that was great. So then as for Rey and Ben's relationship, as I said, that should have been the focus of the whole time. And they kind of had a twin element going on, a little bit like Luke and Leia, down to the incestuous stuff, right? And I didn't like the Luke and Leia flashback. It was so fleeting. It was just an excuse to do more Terminator Dark Fate VFX. They took off their helmets and they're like, look, it looks kind of like digital Luke and kind of like digital Leia. And you're like, stop trying to make up for what you didn't do. But I didn't like that Leia never became a real Jedi. They always try and sell that Leia, they're like, oh yeah, she has a link to the Force. You know, she did the Mary Poppins thing in the last movie. And you're like, in or out? Are you a Jedi or not? And I didn't like that she's like, she stopped training because she could sense that her son would go, something bad would happen to her son if she did. I'm like, well, newsflash, it happened anyway. So you might as well have been a cool Jedi in the process. And maybe she could have fought her own son. That would have been awesome. But no! Also, it could have been a cool movie about a trilogy about, you know, forget Rey. Why don't you just have Leia and Han, and then Luke is the uncle trying to save Ben. That could have been cool too, but no, we don't do that either. All right, the next, another reveal was that Janna and all those people on those stupid horses, they're horses. I don't care what you do to them in post, they're horses. They're ex-stormtroopers, right? So, first off, I didn't understand why she was so dedicated to Finn, who she just met. She was like, I'll take you on the skiff across these waves. It'll surely kill us. I'll go down with the ship with you. I'm like, Jenna, you just met this guy. I'd be like, good luck, buddy. Although I thought Finn was much more charismatic in this movie. But then also, so what's the reveal here? All stormtroopers are reluctant, right? Is that why they're bad? Are stormtroopers bad on purpose because they were drafted and this is their way of, like, you know, being a conscientious objector? Then I feel bad about killing them after all these movies when they were in fact trying to help you. Like, they're like, nobody could be that bad. We're trying to let you escape, dummy. I mean, I thought that was weird. I mean, stormtroopers have been one of the coolest elements of Star Wars. I love seeing stormtroopers march, you know, at conventions, etc. But now they're just making them a joke. All right, speaking of jokes, Zorri Bliss. What a waste of Keri Russell. I'm a big Keri Russell fan after The Americans, but here, she just did nothing. You know, although you can really tell her voice. She has a very distinct voice. That one moment when she was talking to Poe, and she took away her eye visor so she could really look him in the eye, right? I was like, way to put on a lot of eye makeup there, Zorri Bliss. She's like, well, it's the feature that only can be exposed to the public. That and her hair. I don't know if it was bothering anyone else, but she had wisps of hair coming out of her helmet when she opened the front. And I was like, when you close the helmet up, is the hair going to be sticking out of the helmet? Like, what's happening? They obviously did it to make her seem, you know, more like a romantic love interest in the scene. But it was really bothering me from, like how it would work in real life situation. And then also, speaking of a romantic interest, I don't know why she kept talking to Poe if she wasn't going to kiss him. I mean, the first time, it looked bad. I don't know why she couldn't give him a goodbye kiss. I thought that was very nice. And then she was like, no. But then later, it was funny when he was like, how about now? That was funny. But then I thought it was weird when she was still like, nope. I was like, maybe the helmet is stuck on there. And that's the real problem, right? I don't know. I thought that was weird. But I did like her little droid mechanic buddy. He was adorable. He's like, yay! I thought he was great. He's a little like a minion. Much better than the alien who gave them the transmission from the spy at the beginning, who looked like the mime Pokemon from that movie. Then as for Rose Tico, they've worked so hard to try and support her with the fan community and at Star Wars Celebration, but then they undercut her by giving her no role in the movie. I thought that was ridiculous. She went to the premiere, everyone's like, yeah, support Rose Tico, except in the movie where it matters. I thought that was ridiculous. And then they had, let's talk about the lesbian kiss. J.J. Abrams is patting himself on the back for adding. He's like, hey, you can't insult the movie. I put a lesbian kiss in it. And you're like, it was a bad, stupid one that only works because of the Hallmark controversy that just happened. That makes it seem like a bigger deal than it would have probably originally been. I mean, who was that character? They had her do that line about, you can't talk to the general right now because she's dead. Now, that's the only reason she delivered that line. So later you'd be like, oh yeah, it's that lady. But it was in a wide shot in a big group with a big group, and it's easily cut for the foreign market. So there, you know, don't go there if you're not going to go there. That's time on screen that could have been given to somebody else who desperately needed it.
Let's talk about Finn and Poe. I loved Finn and Poe. I thought it was funny they co-generaled. I thought that was hilarious. And I liked, that was one of my favorite moments where Poe was like, I can't do this without you. I want you to be my co-general. And Finn was trying to tell him something else, but he stops for a second and he goes, thank you for that. I thought that was great. They had such a good repartee. I liked light speed skipping. I've seen a couple of people criticize it, but I thought that was really thrilling at the beginning of the movie. I loved when they jumped. It was a lot of work to get a transmission. I was like, you couldn't have emailed that to me? But I guess they needed a hard line. But it seemed like a ridiculous risk. But I liked when they light speed jumped out of that system, right? And the TIE fighters light speed jumped after them. I was like, oh, this is awesome. That was very cool. And I liked going from place to place with the skipping. It worked for me. I thought it was neat. I thought both of them were hilarious, Finn and Poe. I loved when they were playing against Chewie and they were talking to each other. Again, their banter. Fantastic. He cheats. Oh, we're not going to turn it off. And then they turned it off. It was so funny. Speaking of funny, but like not in a good way, Poe was for two movies now has been like, I want to lead. And he finally got to lead and he got so many people killed. He seemed like a very bad leader to me. I think Leia should have picked someone else. But he was squeaky wheel gets the grease. Somebody else should have whined about being a leader for two movies and maybe they would have gotten the job. Now, speaking of people getting killed, again, so many people got killed. Like, they have that shot of the starship exploding and Richard E. Grant gets blown out the front window. But there were a lot of other people on the ship with him that we just saw. And it was weird thinking that so many people followed the First Order. All those ships and that fleet had to be manned that Palpatine created. That's a lot of people who are, they're not automated. So that's a lot of people who are willing to join the First Order or whatever. And, you know, also, there are a lot of people on the rebellion side. And, you know, Richard E. Grant was like, where'd they get such a big fleet? And his underling was like, they're just people. They're not just people. They're people who happen to have starships manned with guns. So it's not even like a Dunkirk situation where they just had, like, boats that weren't military. I mean, like, they can fire back. I mean, it's a little bit political for me. It's a little bit seems like pro-gun, but then also, it's weird. It's like pro-gun, but it also seems like anti-Trump at the same time. I'm like, I don't want any of that in my Star Wars movie. It's a fantasy. Also, it's bothered me for the whole trilogy that the Resistance is a total failure. Total failure! Why did we waste all that time with the original trilogy if they accomplished nothing and another group rose to power? I much would have preferred for this trilogy to have the Resistance government in place and then other problems arise. I don't know why it always has to be rebels versus a big government. There are other stories to tell in Star Wars, as evidenced by other Star Wars stories that are being told. Then I guess I have to talk about C-3PO. I thought that it was a good plot twist that he couldn't translate Sith. He was forbidden from translating him. I thought that was good. But overall, he was just too annoying a character. It's difficult to write an annoying character like that and not make them too annoying. And this movie failed in that regard. I think it always benefited him in the original trilogy that he was balanced out with R2-D2. And I never understood why they swapped out R2-D2 for BB-8. Because BB-8 looks more like a soccer ball? Please. R2-D2 is the original. And he's really good at keeping C-3PO in line. BB-8 never talks back to C-3PO. And I think now they had the humans do it. I thought it was funny, though, when Poe was like, you know, when C-3PO was introducing himself and again, because his memory had been wiped, and Poe was like, this is going to be a problem. I thought that stuff was great. So I think C-3PO without R2-D2 is no good. So as for my conclusion, I'm glad to see the story finished. As I said in my non-spoiler review, I like to finish stories, so I'm glad I got to the end. But I really feel that Jedi Knights are the special sauce here with their lightsabers and their code and their force use and, you know, telekinesis. So I'm particularly looking forward in that regard to the Obi-Wan series. And I like the Star Wars world, but I think that maybe they should focus more on that and less on these family lines. You know, I think that's less interesting. They should just take a break and start fresh. All right, so that's my spoiler review of Star Wars, The Rise of Skywalker. I'm very curious to hear your thoughts down below. Subscribe today. And of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.